Hello dear student, in this video we are going to learn about the analysis of brass. Generally, first, what is brass? Brass is an alloy of copper and zinc. I think you know very well about alloy. What is an alloy? Alloy is a mixture of two or more metals. Alloy is a mixture of two or more metals in definite proportions. It is called as an alloy. For example, brass, bronze, solder, these are the examples for alloys. Means an alloy contains two or more metals in definite proportions. Example, brass, bronze, solder, etc. Okay, now what is brass? Brass is an alloy of copper and zinc. So what are the major metals which are present in brass? They are copper and zinc. Of course, to impart improved properties of strength and resistance to corrosion, certain other alloying elements like manganese, iron, silicon, aluminium, nickel are also added in small amounts to commercial brasses. So brass will combined with, means copper and zinc mixture may combined with manganese, iron, silicon, aluminium and nickel. They are added to the brasses to improve the properties of strength of that alloy and resistance to corrosion. What is corrosion? It is a destruction of metal or metallic equipment. So to resist corrosion, these will be added. Okay, right. So next, according to the definition of alloy, it is a mixture of two or more metals in definite proportion. Definite proportion means the alloy contains how much amount of copper, how much amount of zinc, if manganese is present, how much percentage, iron, how much percentage, silicon, how much percentage, aluminium, how much percentage, nickel, how much percentage. So that is called as proportion. Okay, right. For example, the brass contains copper percentage, it is 50 to 90%, zinc it is 20 to 40%, tin it is 0 to 6%, lead it is 0 to 2%, iron it is less than 1%. Okay, it is in 0.0 some percentage also. Okay, right. So these are the, what are they? Copper, zinc, tin, lead and iron are the major constituents which are present in brass with this proportion. with this proportions. Means brass may also contain another alloying elements, like it may contain manganese, it may contain silicon, it may contain aluminium, it may contain nickel also. Okay, right. But the major constituents are these five. According to our MSc Analytical Chemistry 4th semester syllabus, we need to determine the constituents like copper, zinc, tin, lead and iron, which are present in brass. So our aim is to determine the different constituents which are present in brass. It is called as analysis of brass. It is the analysis of brass. In analysis of brass, which constituents must be determined according to our syllabi? First, copper, determination of copper. So analysis of brass, first one, determination of copper, determination of zinc, determination of tin, determination of lead and determination of iron. Okay, if you know how to determine these five constituents in brass, so in our syllabi we can complete the analysis of brass topic. Okay, right. Just for your information, our third paper, that is applied analysis, contains 4 units. First unit contains the 2 parts, part A and part B. First part is analysis of non-ferroalloys or non-ferrous alloys. Second part contains analysis of ferroalloys. Okay, so in first part we have 3 subtopics. They are analysis of brass, bronze and solder. So in this video we are learning about the analysis of brass. In analysis of brass, what constituents or which constituents to be determined? First, determination of copper, determination of zinc, determination of tin, determination of lead and determination of iron. Okay, so first let us discuss about the determination of copper present in brass. For the determination of copper, there are generally 2 methods are there. First method is just titration method, it is iodometric method. Second one used to determine copper in brass is electrogravimetric method. Okay, right. Electrogravimetric method. In titration method, you need to dissolve the brass sample by using HNO3 solution and H2SO4 solution. Okay, dissolution of brass sample After dissolution, take the brass sample and neutralize with base and add some acetic acid, and then add potassium iodide solution. Which solution? Potassium iodide solution, and keep it in dark place. So keep the conical flask in dark place. Then this potassium iodide will be oxidized to iodine because of the copper which is present in the brass solution. Then the liberated iodine can be titrated against hyposolution, that is sodium thiosulfate solution, that is Na2S2O3 solution, using the indicator, that is starch indicator, so which can change the color into blue. So blue color is the end point in this titration. Okay, right. Once again, just I wish to repeat this titration method, that is iodometric titration method. In iodometric titration method, what is the process? Dissolve the brass sample in HNO3 acid, then add H2SO4, then neutralize it with base and add acetic acid, and then add excess amount of potassium iodide solution. After that, you need to keep it in dark place. Okay, for 10 to 20 minutes for the complete liberation of iodine. So my question, or our question, is why should we keep in dark place after the addition of potassium iodide solution? Right, unless you keep the conical flask after the addition of potassium iodide solution, then that potassium iodide can react with the sunlight, so that it can be oxidized as iodine because of the various reasons. So that is the reason why, to prevent the oxidation of potassium iodide into iodine in environmental condition. So to prevent that, you need to keep it in dark place. Then what happens? Only copper ions which are present in the conical flask. Where the copper ions from? Generally these copper ions present in brass solution. Is it clear? Copper ions present in brass solution. So in brass solution, they contains copper ions. That copper can oxidize potassium iodide into iodine. Okay, then after the liberation of iodine, quantitative liberation of iodine, which is exactly equal to copper ions which are present in brass solution. Okay, then the liberated iodine can be titrated against hyposolution using starch as indicator, so that it can give the end point, that is blue color. So this iodometric titration method is indirect method. It is the indirect method for the determination of copper which is present in brass solution. Why we call it as indirect method means here we cannot measure the copper ions directly. Okay, we can measure the liberated iodine, or we can titrate the liberated iodine which is influenced by the copper ions. So the liberated iodine is quantitatively equal to the copper ions which are present in brass sample solution. So after that, by calculation, we can get the copper which is present in the brass solution. So this is the iodometric titration method which can be used to determine copper which is present in the brass solution. So this is the first method, or one of the method to determine the copper which is present in brass solution. I think it is very clear. So what should you do? Take the brass sample solution, add potassium iodide solution, next keep it in dark place, then the copper ions which are present in brass solution can oxidize the potassium iodide as iodine, then the liberated iodine is quantitatively equal to the copper. Okay, then the liberated iodine is titrated against hyposolution by using starch indicator which can produce blue color end point. So this is the first method to determine the copper which is present in brass sample solution. Okay, right. Next, second method for the determination of copper present in brass sample. Okay, so it is electrogravimetric method. What is this? It is electrogravimetric method. So the principle involved in this method is electrolysis process. In this method, the principle involved is electrolysis process. Means, take the sample solution by producing the conditions. Then the electrolysis process takes place. In electrolysis process, so what are the principles involved, or what is the principle involved? Generally, in electrolysis process, two electrodes are there. So one of the electrode is called as anode, one of the electrode is called as anode, and another one is called as cathode. So these are the two electrodes which are present in electrolysis process. So what happens? What is the principle? If you apply the current, or if you pass the current through the electrolytic solution, then the solution contains, generally the electrolytic solution contains positive ions and negative ions. Generally, in electrolysis process, anode is denoted by positive and cathode is denoted by negative. Okay, right. Generally, we know very well, positive ions attracted by the negative electrode, and the negative ions are attracted by the positive electrode. So according to the electrolysis principle, what happens? The positively charged ions can go towards cathode. So this is the principle in electrogravimetric method. So what happens here? Generally, if you prepare, after preparing the brass sample solution, just remove the interferences. After removal of interferences, that solution contains only copper ions in it. So these copper ions will be deposited at cathode. So we need to measure or weigh the initial weight of the electrode. We need to weigh the initial weight, or we need to know the initial weight of cathode. Okay, let it be W1. Okay, final weight of cathode after completion of the experiment, final weight of the cathode to be determined. So let it be W2. Then the amount of copper deposited on the electrode can be calculated by using the formula W2 minus W1. That is final weight of cathode minus initial weight of cathode will give the amount of copper which is present in the sample solution, that is electrolytic solution. So this is the principle involved in electrogravimetric method. So now I wish to show the procedure to determine the copper which is present in brass sample solution. Just try to observe the procedure to determine copper by using electrogravimetric method. Okay, try to observe here. So for the determination of copper, we need sulfuric acid and nitric acid mixture. It can be obtained by adding 300 ml of H2SO4 to 750 ml of water, cool it and add 210 ml of HNO3 solution. This is the sulfuric acid and nitric acid mixture which is used for the dissolution purpose, dissolution of brass. Do you know what is brass? In Telugu, brass is nothing but ittadi. Do you know ittadi? Ittadi telusu kada meeku? Ittade, brass ante ittade. Okay, danni dissolve cheyadaniki sulfuric acid nitric acid mixture use chestam. Okay, it is the process to produce the sulfuric acid and nitric acid mixture. Okay, next, potassium permanganate solution, it also requires just dissolve 2 gram of KMnO4 in water and dilute it to 100 ml. Next, manganese nitrate solution, dilute 4 ml of commercially available manganese nitrate solution to 100 ml with water. Okay, let us observe the procedure. Okay, what is the procedure? Just transfer 2 gram of the sample to 300 ml electrolysis beaker. So we need to take 2 gram of sample into a beaker. Okay, and add 30 ml of H2SO4 HNO3 solution for the dissolution purpose, and then cover it and allow to stand for few minutes until reaction has been ceased. Generally, what happens if you add HNO3 solution to the brass sample, there is a liberation of nitrate in the form of brown fumes. Okay, then heat at 80 degrees Celsius to 90 degrees Celsius until the dissolution is completed. then brown fumes have been expelled. They are nitrate gas. Okay, next, wash down the cover glass and ante cover chesina glass ni wash cheseyandi ante no material should be drawn out, and the sides of the beaker also, and dilute about to 175 ml. So this is the solution preparation. Up to this solution preparation. Next, you need to insert the electrodes. You need to insert the electrodes. What are they? Anode and cathode. Then cover the solution with a pair of split watch glass and electrolyze at a constant density, about bypassing 0.6 ampere per square decimeter, about 16 hours. Okay, electrolysis process for 16 hours. Next, quickly withdraw the cathode from the electrolyte while directing a gentle stream of water from a wash bottle over of ethanol or acetone, just for drying process. Okay, so what should you do after completion of electrolysis process? Take out the electrode, that is cathode, okay, which contains copper deposition. Just dry in oven for at 110 degree Celsius for 3 to 5 minutes, just for drying purpose. After that, cool it and weigh it. Then the percentage of copper can be calculated by using this formula. Nothing is there, just a simple process. So what should you do to determine the copper? To determine the copper in brass sample solution, what should you do? Take a beaker, take 2 grams of brass sample, add acid mixture for the dissolution purpose, cover it with a watch glass. Okay, after that, remove the watch glass, wash the watch glass. Washings to be added to the solution, and wash the beaker sides also. Okay, after that, expel the nitrate gas, that is brown fumes. Okay, after that, add water in it. So this is the electrolytic solution. Then after that, dip 2 electrodes, one as anode, another one as cathode, and pass the current through it, okay, at 0.6 ampere per decimeter. Okay, after that, do the process for 16 hours. After completion of this 16 hours, take out the cathode, which contains the copper ions in it, copper deposition in it, then wash it with water and add acetone or ethanol for the drying purpose, then dry it in a chamber. After that, take out the electrode, then weigh the electrode, then initial weight of the electrode minus final weight of the electrode will give the information about the amount of copper which is deposited on the electrode. Okay, if you wanted to know the percentage of copper, then percentage of copper is equal to formula weight of copper by weight of brass sample which is taken, into 100 will give the information about the percentage of copper which is present in the brass sample. Okay, so this is the way to determine copper which is present in brass sample. Okay, there are 2 methods are there. One is iodometric method and another one is electrogravimetric method. Thank you for your kind attention to this video. Thank you.